One Day in the Haram is an insider's look at the most sacred site of Muslims, the Great Mosque of Mecca, which houses the Kaaba. The film has recently been shown in Toronto to sold-out crowds. Our executive producer, Mamoun Hassan, sat down with film director Abrar Hussain to find out more about the film.
Welcome to our show.
Alhamdulillah, thank you very much.
So this is a great project, alhamdulillah, that you've embarked upon. I want to ask a couple of questions, first of all, about the idea itself. How did you think of doing this?
I think it was a long, drawn-out process. You know, I always wanted to do something for the Haram. Mm-hmm. I always wanted to do something in Makkah, but it just seemed like it was something that was so far away and that there was just no opportunity or didn't seem to be any chance to do it. But alhamdulillah, through some twist of fate, I ended up in Saudi Arabia on another job. I was actually commissioned for a shoot in a hospital there. And while I was shooting this thing in Saudi Arabia, I was only there for 10 days shooting this hospital film, and I met somebody called Abdullah Al-Ahmari, mm-hmm. who eventually ended up becoming the executive producer on One Day in the Haram. And he basically said to me, stay in Saudi Arabia. You know, we need a producer here, stay mm-hmm. here with us. I didn't really want to stay in Saudi mm-hmm. Arabia for many different reasons. Mm-hmm. I missed my family, I missed London, and there was a lot of things going on at that time. But I said to him, I said, if we can do something on the Haram, mm-hmm. then I'll stay in Saudi. So that was where the initial kind of spark of the idea came. But we didn't have anything at that point. We didn't have a concept, or that it was going to be about the workers, or it's going to be One Day in the Haram. Nothing like that. All we had was just a very good intention to do something really positive for the Haram, something that was going to look beautiful, something that was going to be compelling and comprehensive. You know, mm-hmm. that's what we wanted, something that was going to be a benchmark for the Haram and something that audiences all over the world could respond to and enjoy and appreciate.
That's a beautiful idea. So you actually brought up the concept itself, but I didn't want to talk too much about the films because I don't want to give it away. But the concept itself is basically a One Day in the Haram. Tell us a little bit about what is it that the film itself is trying to tell.
Yeah, I'll tell you a really amazing story, actually, mm-hmm. if you want. Because what happened was we didn't have a concept for the longest time because there were so many different ideas. I actually wrote 6 different treatments mm-hmm. and presented them, and each of them got rejected for some way or other. And what we did is we actually commissioned a writer, a very professional writer in Saudi Arabia, an Arabic guy, to write the script for One Day in the Haram. And what happened is just 2 weeks before the shoot, he had 2 months, and 2 weeks before the shoot, he was like, I can't do it. Mm-hmm. Literally, I can't do it. I just can't do it. So he was like, what's going on? So the exec turns around to me and he says, Abrar, you have to write the film. Mm-hmm. I was like, subhanAllah, how can this 2 weeks till we're shooting, how can I write the script? Mm-hmm. So I was very worried and, you know, I was very, very upset about this. And, mm-hmm. you know, the pressure was immense, you know, because there was a lot of money involved and a lot of things had been arranged, pre-arranged, and it was all coming together in less than 2 weeks. So I went to sleep that night and subhanAllah, when I went to sleep, I had no idea. When I woke up, I had everything. So mm-hmm. as soon as I woke up, in that morning, I knew that the film was going to be about the workers. I knew it was going to be the social media department. I knew it was going to be spread across the 5 prayers. I knew everything. I even knew specific shots that were going to go in the film. All of this came just like that. And, you know, I spent that morning just scribbling furiously in my notebook and writing all the ideas for the concept. And that's where the actual concept of the film came from. Mm-hmm. And alhamdulillah, we were very lucky because that concept, when we then presented the treatment for that concept to the Haram, everyone liked that idea, you know, across the board. So it was, mashallah, it was just alhamdulillah.
Yeah, alhamdulillah. So, I mean, I'll tell you something. I lived in Saudi Arabia, and every time I tried to enter the Haram with some sort of camera, it got confiscated or it got taken away from me. I got a Canon taken away. I've got a GoPro taken away.
You were lucky
away.
You didn't get arrested.
Yeah, exactly, right? Yeah. What is it that you had to do to get this really off the road or even authorized, I guess?
Yeah.
Because the Saudis are quite protective of the actual Haram itself and who enters it and what kind of information comes out of it.
Yeah. I mean, it was a very long and drawn out process. I mean, it took us 8 months just to get the permissions, 8 months of basically presenting different treatments and ideas and plans and to different bodies. And there's so many bodies with a vested interest in the Haram. There's a lot of signatures that you need to get something authorized like that. You know, but the thing is, we could have gone to Haram and done something small, and you know, I could have done that very quickly, but you know, I really wanted to do something comprehensive, which meant that I wanted complete access to everything else. I didn't want to do it. So, you know, we were very, very fortunate that one of our contacts in the Haram Media Department managed to get us an audience with Sheikh Sudais. And once we got in front of Sheikh Sudais, I pitched
everything
the idea.
Ahead.
Yeah, everything moved very quickly from there because, you know, he liked the idea. And because he liked the idea, suddenly all the kind of aides were coming to me saying, okay, what do you need? Mm-hmm. What do you need? We're gonna make this happen. Mm-hmm. So, alhamdulillah, from that point it was very, very quick. But to be honest, you know, I think with the Haram, you're right in what you said, that, that there's a lot of distrust of media.
Yeah.
And I think the legacy of this film, One Day in the Haram, is not that we made a beautiful film yeah. about the Haram. It's actually that we've opened the doors for other filmmakers. Mm-hmm. Because the Haram, for the first time, has seen the power of media. They've seen yeah. how this film has inspired people, millions of yeah. people all over the world. You know, it's on so many channels and, you know, in so many screenings, in so many different countries of the world. And they've seen that for the first time. And it's reassured them that, you know, media is something very powerful, and it can be a very powerful tool for dawah and, mm-hmm. and for positivity for Islam. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think, as I say, the legacy of this film will be that now other filmmakers can come in and push the thing on further, you know, come and make something even more beautiful, even more comprehensive than One Day in the Haram. But I think the real legacy is that we've opened those doors and you know, we've opened the doors for other creatives to come in and have an impact now.
Mm-hmm. What did they think of it?
They were very pleased with it.
I was going to ask,
yeah.
Is that the if Sheikh Sulayth has seen it?
Yeah, they had a screening mm-hmm. Where they viewed the film. You know, and people gave their feedback. I was very, very surprised, because I was very worried before that screening, because mm-hmm. I thought they're going to cut this film to you know, they're going to cut mm-hmm. it to shreds, or, yeah. or you know, they're going to be so. But alhamdulillah, I have to be completely honest. The Haram really did not enforce anything on me. They mm-hmm. they left me with complete creative freedom. I did what I wanted to do. I went where mm-hmm. I wanted to go. And in the final cut of the film, they saw literally they only cut two scenes, mm-hmm. and they weren't structural changes or mm-hmm. narrative changes. They were literally just scenes they didn't like. Mm-hmm. For example, one scene I had a really beautiful shot of the Giswa cloth, and mm-hmm. the guy was cutting the Giswa cloth mm-hmm. or the doorway of the Kaaba. Yeah. He was cutting out with a knife. He was just, yeah. you know, it was so skillful what he was mm-hmm. doing. It was amazing the way he was cutting it. Yeah. I thought, wow, this is a really compelling scene. No one's ever seen this before. Yeah. So I had it there in the film, and I really liked it. And they told me, no, we have to cut this scene. And I couldn't understand. I said, why? And they said, it will basically, there's certain Muslims, it's going to hurt them to see the mm-hmm. Giswa being cut like that. Mm-hmm. We don't want that. We don't want them to feel that. And I thought, wow, actually, that's a very valid point. Yeah.
Quite
so in fact, the feedback they gave me, I was actually mm-hmm. receptive to it. I actually liked some of their ideas. So it was a very good working relationship with them. Mm-hmm.
What is it that, I mean, really, now that you've shown the film all around the world in a lot of different places, do you feel like you've gotten out of it what you aim to get?
SubhanAllah, I think, to be honest, there was only one aim at the beginning, and that was just to make something beautiful and comprehensive, something that, you know, it's funny, because I was in Makkah for 8 months, you know, leading up to getting the permissions to make the film.
Yeah.
And during that time, I did the pre-production as if I had the permissions, even mm-hmm. though we didn't have the permissions. Mm-hmm. We were still waiting, and it was 50-50. And many times I thought, many times I thought it is going to be no. It's yeah. how, you know, they're not going to let us do this. Yeah. They've Discovery Channel have come, BBC have come. They haven't let these yeah. guys do it. Why are they going to let us do it?
Yeah.
But you know, but I kept a belief, and you know, the best thing about that pre-production period mm-hmm. was that we prayed in the Haram all the time. Mm-hmm. So every time, and you know, as I was doing my normal prayers, I'd pray for the normal things, my mm-hmm. health, my family, you know, for a play for Syria, for Palestine, for these, you know, I'd pray for many things, but at the end, mm-hmm. I would always do a prayer for the film. Mm-hmm. But my prayer for the film was something like, it wasn't, Ya Allah, please let me make this film. It was more like, look, Ya Allah, if this is going to be something good for Islam, mm-hmm. it's going to be something positive for the Muslims, mm-hmm. then let me have this. And mm-hmm. if it's not, then keep it away from me. Mm-hmm. That was my feeling all the way through. So, you know, we had just such a good intention from the beginning. And I think that spread all the way through the film, through the production and through the post-production as well.
Have you gone through anything with the actual, you know, in the process of making the film itself that have really inspired you? So obviously you've seen things that, not everything that you've seen is really in the film itself, but yeah, I just want to know what are some of the things that really kind of...
I mean, to be honest, there were so many beautiful moments during the filming, and so many small little miracles happened. I mean, I was speaking about the helicopter. Someone asked me in the audience yeah. about the helicopter shots, and I was saying
tell us about that.
You know, well, with the helicopter, it's like we ran out of money, we ran out of budget, but I knew these shots were very, very important. I was mm-hmm. very disheartened, like I felt very down that I'm not going to be able to get these shots. I'm going to have to cut these mm-hmm. shots out because we mm-hmm. so literally we haven't got the money for it.
Mm-hmm.
And then what happened is suddenly got a call, and it's somebody from the Saudi Air Force saying they'd heard about the project and they were going to give us helicopters mm-hmm. so we could fly around Makkah. We actually ended up having four flights of 2 hours each around Makkah. So for 8 hours, beautiful. I was just shooting the city of Makkah. It was amazing.
Yeah.
Another amazing thing that happened there, you know, when they opened the doors of the helicopter, we're up there in the sky, they opened the doors for the helicopter, and I was literally terrified. My heart was beating so fast because there was no safety harness.
Yeah.
It was literally just there with the Ronin and the Ari, and there was nothing holding us, and I was scared. But when I sat there and I started filming, I looked at what I was filming, I saw Makkah, I saw the Haram, I saw the Kaaba from up there. Suddenly I just had no fear at all. Suddenly I was just completely calm and everything was beautiful. I think this was just another of the little miracles that happened. But I think that the main thing that happened for me personally during this shoot is the feeling that everything is ordained by Allah was just so strong. Mm-hmm. It was strong at the beginning, and as the filming progressed, it just got more and more to the extent where I just wasn't worried about anything because, you know, I felt to myself, if we're here at this time, in this place, doing this particular work, then that has been ordained for us. Mm-hmm. We're meant to be here mm-hmm. at this time, doing this job. And, mm-hmm. and actually that feeling I had was, I got that feeling from all the workers that I interviewed.
Yeah.
Because all the workers, all they said is that they felt they had been chosen by Allah to work in the Haram. That's yeah. the feeling of everyone in the Haram. Mm-hmm. And that transcended onto us, onto the crew. We felt like that as well. So mm-hmm. the thing I took away from it was just such a strong belief that, you know, everything is ordained by Allah and you know, you just have to have faith and believe in, and good things will happen.
Mm, perfect. You mentioned the workers as well. I kind of just want to come a little bit to some of this. And some of the audience have always mentioned this. And I ask you this just to kind of get your thoughts, really, in a sense. But the vast majority of people whom you've spoken to in the film itself, they're Saudis. And I think there's only one non-Saudi you've spoken to there. Tell me a little bit about that.
I think what people have to understand is that the Haram is a reflection of the country that it's in. It's a reflection of Saudi culture as well. In Saudi culture, I mean, especially in the last kind of 5 years, well, I was in Saudi for 3 years during the build-up to this and the production of this film. While I was living in Saudi all the time, there was a whole kind of Saudiization of the country yeah. going on, where, you know, the top jobs and the top management positions mm-hmm. were all from government level were all being pushed towards mm-hmm. Saudis because they had a massive unemployment problem. They had a lot of social issues there with a yeah. high rate of unemployment, a lot of young people who didn't have work, and so they were trying to get you know, the expats kind of out and more of these in, and the Haram is a reflection of this. In fact, I found that every single department, that the head of every department was a Saudi national, and the senior managers were all Saudi nationals. Mm. There were no non-Saudis in that kind of management kind of positions. Mm. Just a tier below them, then there were a lot of workers, you know, like, for example, the brother that we saw, the cleaner, and he was very important to the film. I felt he was one of the key scenes in the whole film because he was actually one of the people who's doing the work on the ground. Mm-hmm. And I did get the kind of polite suggestion from them, hey, why don't you take the head of the cleaning department and mm-hmm. then interview him and profile him. He was a Saudi guy. And yeah. I said, no, because I don't want the guy who's sitting behind the desk, yeah. you know, organizing or doing. I want the guy who's actually doing the work on the ground. I think that's the most important. And the funny thing is, out of the reactions from the audience, is that scene with that cleaner is, mm-hmm. is one of the most
effective.
Yeah, it's one of the parts that the audience has really loved and related to, because mm-hmm. he really speaks from the heart and he speaks like a normal person, you know. I think that's been one of the most popular scenes in the film.
Hey YouTube, we hope you benefited from this video. If you liked it, or if you didn't, let us know in the comments below. And if you're interested in learning more, check out some of our other videos. And don't forget to subscribe so you can get new videos every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday.